on the DVD of the film. The film hasn't aired yet on the Golf Channel. That's a more complicated situation. But I think what's important, again, is that you know which festivals are right for your movie.
Yeah.
You know,
yeah.
And I knew what was right for the Back Nine, having been in the festival game a while. So I played the right festivals, and then I moved on into distribution.
Yeah. Now, since then, what have you been doing a documentary on?
Well, most recently, I've spent the last year and a half developing a company called Cinecause, which connects socially relevant films like the documentaries and the movies that are made based on Filmmaking for Change. It connects those movies to related causes. So
I think that's great. I have to tell you, when I read that in this book, I thought, that's really where it's all at. Because you can go to any studio, I'm talking about a major studio, and there's so much junk that they're doing because they could get a star for X month, and so they do it. But to do something, well, Argo, I found that's a film with a cause.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that is a film that we will certainly promote. I've been traveling so much. I've just got back from my fourth trip in less than 2 months, so I have to get back to the Cinecause. But the idea being that people are inspired by these movies. People like to be entertained while learning something, and we've seen that film has become the most powerful form of mass communication, film and media, and why not leverage that power and connect these movies to causes? Because what happens is people could see a movie like The Cove or An Inconvenient Truth in the theater, but then they're not really sure what to do about it.
Yeah.
There's some amazing documentaries that have been made in the last few years, but if you don't really know how to get involved or how to take action, then it's almost a missed opportunity. So Cinecause is trying to take these stories and connect them to causes, and in some cases celebrities and you know, Ben Affleck, perfect example. But the Cinecause kind of led me to think more about making more of these documentaries, mm-hmm. and I was introduced to a team of producers that come from the lactation and kind of the baby business, if you will.
Yeah.
They're not film people, they're in the business of helping mothers with the process of breastfeeding. And they know that there's a huge problem with breastfeeding in America and that we're on the bottom rung in terms of success rate. And there are countries like Sweden and Norway that are number one and two. And why are they so good? And why have we lost this cultural element, this lost element?
How long will that documentary be?
Most of the documentaries that I've worked on kind of fall into that 75 to 85 time frame.
Mm-hmm.
I don't feel like most documentaries can sustain past 85, 90 minutes.
Mm-hmm.
It's just not that kind of structure.
Yeah.
So my hunch is the movie will come in under 85 minutes. We started shooting in Berlin and Sweden last month, and it's going very well. And I think it's going to really spark some interest, because I think a lot of people don't realize is the formula companies.
Did you direct it?
Yeah, I'm directing.
Yeah.
A lot of people don't understand that the formula companies are really, in a way, brainwashing America into thinking it's okay.
Mm-hmm.
And also people don't realize the value of the connection between mother and child. It's not just the nutritional value.
Yeah.
It's the bonding.
In which case, because you talk about Michael Moore, his films have a Michael Moore touch.
Mm-hmm.
No matter what they do, it's the importance of getting a rhythm and a pacing to it. But again, how do you do that within the subject of lactation?
Well, I think there'll be a number of different elements. Certainly, there will be a small piece of Michael Moore, if you want to think of it that way. I mean, ultimately, we will be talking to formula companies, and we will want to hear what they have to say about this. The team around this movie, it doesn't have the Michael Moore tone necessarily, but I think what we want to do is really wrap in what is going on in America, what went wrong, why did we drop, what's going on over here that really works, and then add another layer of connecting the history of the arts and what's been done with paintings and sculptures,
uh-huh.
and different works of art. These
yeah.
artists have all, whether it's Da Vinci or Picasso, they've spent time focusing on that
image. Yeah, mother and child.
Madonna, yeah. So I think that that's really going to give the film another interesting layer, and ultimately it's a woman on a quest to get answers. Why have we lost this art and value and phenomenon of breastfeeding?
So the subject matter is a woman searching.
Yeah.
Well, that's part of your hero's
journey.
Journey, yeah. And does she have a star name, or is she?
No, she doesn't have a star name. There are some celebrities that we're going to interview for the project, because a lot of the celebrities, just like any other people, mm-hmm. Breastfeed. So they want to talk about how important this is to them and support the cause. Mm-hmm. But, you talk about the hero's journey. I think one of the things that we cover in the book is the idea that one of the reasons why we believe documentary has really sparked a nerve in the last 10, 15 years is because the structure and the style of them has shifted to a point where there have been a lot more of what I would call a narrative flow to these documentaries, and they feel more like a narrative. They feel more like stories, and there's acts and there's plot points, and they're not the kind of talking heads type documentary that is kind of where the whole genre started. And I think that's going to make a big difference.
I think the amazing one is Michael Apted's, A Life. Because following as he did with these kids in England, it's a fascinating film.
Yeah, those are amazing. And those at the end of the day, and most documentaries at the end of the day, are about people. But I think if you can layer in structure and the hero's journey, and we try to do that with The Highest Pass, and you have this quest, these guys are gonna go on this ride, are they gonna make it to the top of The Highest Pass? And then that journey becomes more important than the quest of getting to the top of the mountain. I think the screen time at the top of the mountain is a minute.
Yeah.
What becomes important are the relationships and the characters that are developed along the journey, and all the themes that are layered in about fear and facing fear. Everybody's got fear, whether it's flying or intimacy or cars or going to the highest spot or driving a motorcycle.
Mark Litwack is an attorney who answers a lot of questions here.
Yeah, Mark Litwack is an amazing person. He's actually one of the first people I met when I graduated from film school. I read his book called Real Power when I graduated from UCSB and contacted him fairly soon after that, and he was kind enough to take a meeting. I was just, a film grad. And then after doing Slam Dance a few years later, we invited him out there, and he became a big supporter of Slam Dance.
Where is Slam Dance held?
Slam Dance in Park City, same time as Sundance.
Oh.
Hence the name Slam Dance. Yeah. Well, it was created as an alternative because we didn't get into Sundance, and we felt like,
we'll show you.
Why not go up and show our films anyway?
Yeah.
But Litwack has written a lot of books about the industry and about contracts, and he's a filmmaker's attorney. He's really a champion in supporting filmmakers.
What did you get from AFI? What did you learn there?
AFI was amazing because Slam Dance was this little festival done on a micro budget, and we only showed 10 films the first year. I think we went up to 30 or 40 the next year, but AFI was a I want to say 10 day, it was either 7 or 10 days. It was a longer event. And Gene Furstenberg was the CEO at the time, gave me a blank canvas to do what I wanted to do. And we introduced competitive sections. We brought in American Independence. We really developed out a really broad sponsorship program. I learned a lot about marketing there. I learned a lot about sponsorship. And I saw thousands of movies and traveled to Berlin and Cannes and all the major festivals. So I learned a lot at AFI. I was there for 3 years. And that's where I really learned how to produce a first-class festival.
Yeah, and also how to be a director, because the directing course is excellent there.
Yeah, I didn't take any courses there because I had already gotten my film degree from Santa Barbara, mm-hmm. but But I think, you know, for me, and I mentioned this in the book, any filmmaker or emerging, aspiring filmmaker that's trying to you know, carve their path, what I always recommend is see as many movies as you can. And one of the best things about being a festival director, especially for an organization like AFI, is we had hundreds of movies submitted. So I was seeing hundreds of films. Yeah. So I was learning what was working and what wasn't working. That was my education.
How'd you learn about writing a book?
How did I learn about writing a book? What's interesting is I'd written a few articles on starting a festival for filmmakers, on how to play the festival circuit, finding distribution after finishing your festival circuit. I wouldn't call myself, I never thought of myself as a writer necessarily, but I knew how to write. And I did a panel with Michael Wiese at a film festival, and I had just launched Cinecause, and I said, I have what I think is a good idea for a book, because there's this groundswell of people making movies and people talking about causes and issues and how do I get involved. And Cinecause was really about filmmaking for change. So I said, I have an idea to do this book that I hope will become part of the curriculum in film schools across the country. I would have loved to have read this book when I was in film school. Yeah.
No, this is a book that is absolutely the nuts and bolts and the inspiration. Will you autograph my book, please,
absolutely.
John?
Absolutely.
And if you'd like to know what else we've been reading, visit me on the web at www.conniemartinson.com. You can link into Claremont Graduate University's digital library. They have digitized over 1,000 of our old shows, as well as YouTube, Connie Martinson's channel. But support your local library. Libraries have reams of books on films, as well as films to take out. And we'll see you next time. Thank you very much,
John. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you.